of 4 semester diploma, and we are covering almost complete portion of power electronics and the resource persons for this power electronics portion. So myself, Ravi Bigal, selection gate lecturer, J Polytechnic Bangalore. And Shrimati K Prasanna, selection gate lecturer, SJ Government Polytechnic Bangalore. And Vijay Kumar, GP Vijay Kumar, from selection gate lecturer, Chintamani. And to start with, you know, the power electronics subject is a very versatile subject and very important subject for both electrical as well as electronics engineers. And in the whole lecture, you know, to cover the entire portion of this power electronics, we are referring these 4 important textbooks written by Power Electronics by Dr. P.S. Bimra, Kana Publishers; Industrial Electronics and Control by Biswanath Pol; and Industrial Electronics by Dr. S. Chatterjee; and Power Electronics by Mohammad Rashid. So these are the textbooks. Still more textbooks are available, still you can refer wherever you want, and these are very comfortable and very neatly explained information available in these textbooks, in fact. And now now these are the reference books that you can always refer for your information. And next, the entire power electronics subject is divided into 3 units, as you can see on the screen. Unit 1, comprising of power semiconductor devices, and in fact in this table you have been given the hour allotment as well as marks weightage given to that particular chapter. The power semiconductor devices, this is the chapter number 1, having 12 hours of weightage. SCR control circuits having 6 hours of weightage, which is under unit number 1. Unit 2 carries control rectifiers, choppers, inverters, cycloconverters, and device protection schemes. So you can see the hour allotment over there, as well as marks weightage given to that each topic. And unit 3 is having power supplies and stabilizers, switch mode converters, power electronics application. So totally 54 hours of teaching, and the equal weightage is given. And the weightage given here is only indicative, and plus or minus 5 marks variation may happen depending on the paper setter. In fact, you cannot take it for granted that 32 marks is 100% available. No, it can alter or it can vary depending on the paper setter. It's only a indicative marks allotment, so that if you study, you know, you have to know these things before you write examination. In fact, the power semiconductor devices, so comprises of the basic, it starts from the basic semiconductor devices. You have to learn the basic semiconductor devices, and this course is designed keeping in mind that you have the knowledge of power semiconductor devices. In fact, the basic knowledge of semiconductor devices is required to understand this power semiconductor, power electronics. In fact, it is very much required. So that's why in the chapter number 1, you know, the power semiconductor devices, the layer structure, its characteristics, VI characteristics, and to some extent applications, etc., are being covered in power semiconductor devices. And then you have SCR control circuits, so different control circuits, R firing, firing circuits, and starting methods, turning, turn off methods, etc. All these things are covered in SCR control circuits. Then controlled rectifiers, you know, you have already studied about the basic rectifier circuit. You know, a rectifier is a device which converts AC to DC. Now you see, you are going to learn about controlled rectifiers, then how to control the rectified output. So that is being taught here with different circuits. And then you have choppers. In fact, in case of choppers, you know, how to convert DC to DC converter, variation of fixed DC to variable DC. Now how to develop these circuits, and how exactly the functions of choppers. So all these things will be dealt in chopper unit. Inverters, you know, converting DC to AC, how exactly inverters are developed, and how to develop a single phase inverter circuit, three phase inverter circuits, etcetera, being included in this chapter. And then you have a cycloconverter. So, cycloconverter deals with change in frequency from one frequency to another frequency, step up and step down frequencies. Then in chapter number 7 under unit 2, it is a device protection scheme. So, after studying about these power semiconductor devices, so how to protect them from failures, in fact, that is a device protection scheme devised for this particular power semiconductor devices. And then lastly, you have power suppliers, stabilizers. In fact, these are industrial applications, power supplies and stabilizers, switch mode converters, and some power electronics application pertaining to control of motor speed, etcetera. Only two applications are included in this chapter, in fact, unit number 10. So, totally 54 hours of teaching process with the weightage, indicative weightage given in this table. So, this is overall subject design for power electronics for fourth semester students of electrical engineering branch. Of course, some portions are even common for electronic students also. They learn this thing in industrial automation subject. Okay. Now, coming to the brief history, why this power electronics study is important. So, power electronics belongs to partly to power engineers, that is electrical engineers, and partly to electronics engineers. So, it is a world of power electronics, you know, you have to learn about how this power control is required. So, power control means you have studied in electronics 1 and electronics 2 about the pure basic electrical diodes and Zener diodes, etcetera. Only signal diodes you have studied. Now, in this case, we are dealing with high power levels, high voltage, high current components. Now, the era of power electronics began with the invention of SER by Bell Laboratories in 1957. The entire power electronics industry started its revolution, in fact, from this point. So, this how this power electronics, why study is so important, let us see about this. Power semiconductor devices forms the heart of modern power electronics design. So, you must understand thoroughly about the efficient, reliable and cost effective design of power converters. So, without knowing the actual characteristics of power electronic devices, you cannot design an efficient circuit. So, that is why you have to thoroughly understand the layer structure, its behavior, its VI characteristic and about its application. So, that is important. That is why the study about power electronics is very, very important. And it plays an important role also in design. And of course, these power semiconductor devices, you know, whatever I am speaking now, they are mostly used as switches. Say they are on means they will be under saturation condition, off means they will operate at cutoff mode. So, sometimes later I will be speaking about the characteristics of diode, power diode, etcetera, wherein you will learn about saturation and cutoff. Then basically there are three types of switches. So, the moment you are learning about power electronics, already told you that, keeping in mind that you have the knowledge of basic semiconductor devices like diode, etcetera. So, now this diode you have already studied as it works as rectifier which converts AC to DC. But apart from that, you have another important application, that is diode can be used as a switch, that means cutoff mode and saturation mode. Now, there are three types of switches, that is uncontrolled switch. Uncontrolled switch, the name itself says there is no control over, say switch means just on and off. The switch, it is on and off condition depends on the circuit condition wherein the particular device is being used, based on the circuit condition. So, whether it is on or off, you can decide, say that is uncontrolled switch. Then you have a semi-controlled switch. So, it can be turned on by the gate signal, that is all. You can simply turn on, you cannot turn off by by using a gate signal. So such device is grouped under semi control switch. For example, it is an SCR. So then you have a control switch. So now there is a mark between semiconductor switch, semi control switch, and control switch. Semi control switch, in fact, you have a gate signal to switch on the device. It can switch on, but you cannot turn it off. There are devices like GTOs, gate turn off thyristors. Using gate, you can turn it off also, right? Now control switch, it can be turned on or off by control terminal. Example is BJT. You have studied about transistors, different modes of transistors, right? In case of this transistor, when there is a base current, you can see it is on. When there is no base current, it is off. Now this is acting as a control switch, control signal. So like that, you have three types of switches: uncontrolled switch, semi-controlled switch, and controlled switch, with little example. Then the power electronics application, if you look at this application, you can very well appreciate why the study of this power electronics is required. You can see the list goes on like this. In case of residential application, you can see it in cooking, heating, air conditioning, refrigerator, and lighting controls. In case of commercial application, it finds application in UPS, lighting control circuits, etc. So industrial application is about pumps, blowers, fans, welding controls, etc. So these are only some application listing, that's all, the broad area of this application. In case of transportation area, you can see in tractions, subways, and trolleybus controls. Utility systems like HVDCs, static wires, static circuit breakers. Utility systems means in case of electrical power applications, we can see. This is very important for electrical engineers, because you should know about the application of these power semiconductor devices to control high voltage circuits, right? And in fact, about aerospace application, like satellite power systems, control systems, and telecommunication as battery chargers. It's only a broad application area. So specifically, we'll speak about these things. Application of semiconductor devices, suitability of semiconductor device is also necessary. Now, before going into this, the power semiconductor device, before starting this, I want to brush up the older thing, that is basics about PN junction diode. So that already have studied in electronics 1. The PN junction forms the basic building block for all power semiconductor devices. So you know how to form a P-type semiconductor, you know how to form a N-type semiconductor. When both are having a junction, you know, it forms a PN junction diode. So that has been dealt in our earlier semesters. Now this is the basic building block of all semiconductor devices. Now how to make this junction? So P-type semiconductor brought in metallurgical or physical contact with N-type semiconductor to form a PN junction diode. Now when junction is formed, fine, you are calling it as a semiconductor diode. Now by applying a AC signal, you have converted into a DC semi converter. See, you have full control converter, semi control converter, etc. You have already conducted experiment also, right? But before you start learning about power electronic circuits, you know, power electronics theory, you have to know about the conventions normally used in power electronics books or in literatures. You know, where you have a P-type semiconductor and N-type semiconductor, fine, when they are brought in metallurgical or physical contact, you are going to call it as a PN junction diode. Now the impurity added to the semiconductor plays an important role in further developments. So when the impurity you have, that is equal doping, it is represented as PN, that's all. So what is doping? Once again, doping is the process of adding impurity to the pure semiconductor is called as doping. So, if the doping level is maintained equally, we represent it as Pn, that is all. Now, doping, if p type semiconductor is having more impurity compared to n type semiconductor, it is represented as p plus and n. Plus indicates more doping in p type area. So, this is the other one, p plus n plus, we say both are highly doped. So, this is represented as p plus and n plus. And then when both are lightly doped, it is indicated as p minus and n minus. So, these doping levels are important. So, whenever you study about the structural features of power semiconductor devices, so you have to take care of these things. You must keep track of these things. So, while understanding the literature given in any of the textbooks. So, that is why this representation is an important one to understand the actual behavior of your semiconductor device. Now, coming to the basic thing, that is diode, PN junction diode, how the PN junction diode is formed, and I'm trying to just brush up the older topics that already you have learned. You know this p type semiconductor which has been shown here, p type semiconductor and n type semiconductor, okay. So, when the junction is formed, you can see that is a metallurgical junction. Now, when p type semiconductor, you have majority carriers as holes. N type semiconductor, you have electrons as majority carriers. So, when the junction is formed, so some of the holes try to cross the junction and gets depleted over the N region. They recombine with the electrons. And on the right hand side, you can see this N portion in which electrons are majority carriers. So, because of the junction, say they get transmitted or they get depleted on the P side. So, some of the electrons get recombined with P and remaining they get depleted on the other side. Now, this region is called as a depleted region. So, why it see this depleted region is important for us in designing your power semiconductor device or semiconductor devices. The next slide you can see here, the diffusion junction, at junction you can see the movement of holes and electrons being transmitted from one end to another end, okay. The second diagram, you can see the depletion layer, width of the depletion layer. So, this semiconductor has been shown without power supply. Now, this is actually the depletion region, which we call it as a barrier potential. This barrier potential is important potential, right? We will come to know it later when we draw the VI characteristic. So, this potential plays an important role in switching on conditions. Now, the next diagram you can see in the diagram C, the diode is forward biased. Diode is forward biased. That means the positive supply is connected to p type semiconductor, negative supply is connected to n type semiconductor. Now, when you try to increase the supply, what happens? It will oppose. This barrier potential, we say, this offers opposition to the increase in voltage. Now, in that case, it has to overcome this barrier potential. Then, when it overcomes, we say diode is conducting. Then, the last diagram you can see, it is a reverse bias junction. In case of reverse bias, the positive end of the supply is connected to N, negative end is connected to P type. Now, when you increase the supply, you know the depletion width increases. So, you have to be very specific here. The depletion width increases when it is reverse biased. When the device is forward biased, the depletion width decreases and it makes or it brings your diode under conducting mode. Now, next is your power diode. So, those are some basic things about basic PN junction diode, how PN junction diode is formed and how your diode behaves when it is forward biased and how the diode behaves when it is reverse biased. Okay, so this is the biasing technique adopted for this particular device. Now, power diode. So, this is actually starting point of your power electronics subject. So, we start from this end. So, with the preamble that you have, you know, this knowledge of basic signal diode is required to understand this power diode. And people are some people they think that power diode and signal diode they are same. No, structural features are entirely different. That you have to write. So, that is a very important one. The power diode, once again it is a two terminal device with having PN junction. So, they are usually formed by these techniques. One is alloying. Say how the junction is formed, how you are going to mix up say P and N junction is done by the process called as alloying. So, this alloying technique has already been dealt in electronics one topic. With the presumption that you know these things, so I am not going to elaborate these techniques of alloying, diffusion and epitaxial growth. So, these terminologies are usually used whenever you get explanation regarding these semiconductor devices. So, you should be aware of these techniques, alloying, diffusion technique and epitaxial growth. So, this junction formation of diode. Then, what are the structural features of power diode? So, you have seen a simple signal diode with P junction, P semiconductor and N semiconductor brought in physical contact, it forms a semiconductor diode. Now, what is about power diode? So, this is the actual power diode. You can see you have a N plus substrate above which you have N minus, that is why the conventions are very important here. N plus substrate, it is highly doped N type material, above which you have N minus lightly doped area, and above that you have a P plus diffused into it. Of course, the symbol of power diode will remain same. You have one anode, P plus terminal connected to a terminal called as anode, and N plus substrate you have it as a cathode. The symbol of diode remains as it is. Now, this is the structural feature. Now, the structural feature, it consists of once again N plus substrate. Substrate is a base material on which something grows, epitaxially grown. So, this is the explanation that you have to give about structural features. It consists of a heavily doped N plus substrate, and on this a lightly doped N minus layer is epitaxially grown, and you have a heavily doped P plus layer diffused into this N minus layer. Now, what about the thickness of this N minus layer? The thickness of this N minus layer determines or governs the breakdown voltage of your power diode. So, diode when you are going to forward bias, yes, this plays an important role. This is a determining area. The thickness of N minus layer determines your breakdown voltage. Why breakdown voltage is important? Let us learn little later. So, I am concentrating only on structural features of diode. Now, this is the structural feature. And you can see the drift region or space charge region. In other case, it is having barrier potential, that is a drift region wherein the movement of electrons and holes takes place here. That is called as a drift of electrons. Now, coming to the thickness of N minus layer, the breakdown voltage depends on thickness of this N minus layer. So, in addition of this N minus layer causes the ohmic drop, it increases the resistance of the device. So, you can see once the resistance increases, automatically the power dissipation is high. So, the diode is carrying current. So, the current is flowing in the diode. because of the additional n minus layer, the resistance increases. So when resistance increases, obviously I square R, the power dissipation is more and it produces more heat. So proper cooling arrangement is very much essential for a power diode, and for signal diodes is not required. You can see some of the power diodes. The diagrammatic the symbol R, what you can see, the power diode pictures are shown here. In fact, of course, there are many diodes available in the market, so only a few, only three I have shown here. Of course, it is only for your knowledge sake. Now coming to the characteristics of diode, basic diode I have drawn here. So when you want to learn about VI characteristic, there are two characteristics of diode which are very important. So for a VI characteristic, the diode symbol, its only symbol is shown here with a power supply, and this circuit is a forward biased diode. The anode is connected to plus terminal and cathode is connected to negative terminal. It is a simple diode. Now the VI characteristic, the two characteristics of diode, VI characteristic as well as reverse recovery characteristics, these two characteristics are very important for diode. You can see here, this is a VI characteristic of a signal diode. You can see there, from 0, you know, when you start biasing this particular diode, you know, it starts from 0. Then as and when you increase the supply input, as and when you increase the input, now it will not conduct. You can see the cut in voltage shown over there as 0.7 volts. Now what is this 0.7 volt? Barrier potential I called while explaining the junction formation depletion region, right? So that offers opposite potential to your power supply. Say that voltage is around 0.7 volts for a signal diode. So up to that point, the diode will not conduct. Your diode, no current flows through the load circuit. Then exactly at 0.7, the diode starts conducting slowly. You can see the exponential rise of this current, exponential rise, and the gap, the diagram shown over there is a forward voltage drop, forward voltage drop. Now VI characteristic is like this. So when the diode is forward biased, in the initial portion of the graph as been depicted over there, you have cut in voltage of 0.7. Diode will not conduct though it is forward biased. So at that voltage, new voltage, it starts conducting and it is rising exponentially. Remember, this is for a signal diode, simple PN junction diode, not a power diode. Then if you want the reverse bias, what happens during reverse bias? If you reverse this supply voltage, connect negative to positive, negative supply to the anode, positive supply to the cathode, if you reverse this, it becomes reverse bias. So what happens during reverse bias? Up to the voltage VRRM, that is reverse voltage, only a small leakage current flows through the diode. It will not conduct once again. At exactly the breakdown voltage, we say VRRM, reverse recovery, reverse voltage, the diode suddenly starts conducting and heavy current starts to flow through it. It will destroy the whole diode. So one should not operate the diode at this voltage. So this is an important characteristic. That is why before learning or before using your diode or any component, any semiconductor device, one should learn about the characteristics. the curves play an important role. The data sheets will give you the more information about the behavior of your semiconductor devices whenever they are used in the circuit. So, one should have a knowledge of this characteristics. Now, this is about a simple signal diode or PN junction diode. So, you remember, in case of forward biased signal diode, the rise of current is shown exponentially. Of course, I am not dealing with the equations and all. So, if you go through the equation, it will give you the exponential rise. So, it mathematically it can be expressed that the current rises exponentially. This is not our part for a diploma students. So, we are not dealing with the equations and all. So, you have to know that when a signal diode is forward biased, it shows exponential rise, and in reverse bias, you are going to fix the maximum reverse voltage that the diode can withstand. So, this is reverse voltage. Then coming to power diode, you can see over there, of course, both characteristics remain alike. You can see almost they are same. No. In case, once again, same power diode, the symbol is same, the same diagram you can use. This is biasing of power diode, I am calling, right. Now, the VI characteristic of power diode is almost similar to your signal diode, but what is the difference? In case it is forward biased, you have to look into this barrier potential. Now, earlier it was 0.7, now it will be up to 1.5. So, many of the textbooks they say, it is up to 1.5, even sometimes more. It behaves like this. Whenever you forward bias your power diode, you know, so the current starts, or your signal diode conducts only after this barrier potential. If it overcomes this barrier potential, then only your diode will conduct. Now, what is the difference between this and signal diode? The rise of current, you know, you see, it is almost linear and not exponential. So, this is an important one. So, you should remember, you do not think that power diode and signal diode, they are same. No. So, in characteristics, while writing also, you must be very careful, and you have to indicate properly this voltage, that is forward voltage, forward breakdown voltage. Well, you can say the diode starts conducting, the knee voltage we can say. So, many of you do not write, you know, you simply write it as a diode like this and explain it is a signal diode. Never do that, because power diode is different, signal diode is different, its behavior is different and its application is different. So, that is why when you are writing VI characteristic of power diode, please mention the voltage 1 or 1.5 even. And the characteristic curve is almost linear. And similarly, the power diode, you can reverse bias it. So, whenever you connect a positive end of supply to negative and negative end of supply to positive, we say it is reverse biased. Now, when it is reverse biased, once again the same power diode behaves similar to your signal diode. Now, when you take a diode, you know, for your application, the peak inverse voltage is normally mentioned. What is this peak inverse voltage? Largest reverse voltage diode is subjected to during its working, peak inverse voltage. This particular voltage, you know, voltage rating or specification we can see is very important whenever use your diode in your circuit. Now, why? So, whenever diode is subjected to reverse bias, so it is a destroying in nature. If the voltage is too high, it will destroy your diode. So, you should not go to that level. It gives a permanent damage to your diode. So, that is why while selecting a particular semiconductor device, you know, say especially power diode, peak inverse voltage is very important for us. So that's why forward bias characteristic is also important, reverse bias characteristic is also important. So these characteristics will clearly tell you, will clearly tell the power engineer, electronics engineer, to select a particular device for his application. So this is very important. Of course, the data sheets pertaining to these devices should be first looked into. Now, the reverse recovery characteristics. So now the first one we have studied about the forward bias characteristics. Now what happens to the reverse bias, reverse recovery characteristics, not reverse bias characteristics, sorry. Reverse recovery characteristics. What is this reverse recovery characteristics? This is an important characteristic. Whenever you study about this reverse characteristic, whenever you study about this diode, you know, its diode is applied, is used as a rectifier, yes, of course. The other application is your switch. The other application is a switch. Switch, yes, is totally dependent on this reverse recovery characteristic. See, after the forward diode current decays to 0, whenever it is reverse biased, you can say the diode continues to conduct in reverse direction because of the pressure of stored charges in the depletion region. I think you have a knowledge of depletion region now. The charges are stored there, they have complete lump of whole electrons and holes, so they are making lot of movements inside the junction. Now at this case, when forward current decays to 0, diode continues to conduct in reverse direction. This is very important point that you have to understand now. See, this reverse current flows for a time called as reverse recovery time. The reverse recovery time, reverse current flows through the diode. Now, after this, you know, the diode regains its blocking capability until reverse recovery current decays to 0. It has to regain its blocking capability. See, diode is meant for blocking the forward voltage, right? So diode has to regain, that is a reverse recovery characteristics. You can see here the reverse recovery characteristic curve is drawn like this. The first graph, it is shown on the screen, you know. So this is reverse recovery graph. Now this particular one, you can see here, is it? This particular, is it? This one, this reverse recovery characteristic. Exactly at this point, the current, when it is 0, the diode is continuing to conduct. So this is the area reverse recovery time. So this time is comprising of TA and TB, TA and TB here, TA and TB. As soon as the forward current decays to 0, then diode has started continuously conducting for this much of time. This is called as reverse recovery time, reverse recovery time. Now this shaded area, this is reverse recovery charge. Remember, this is the graph drawn between current and time, current versus forward current IF with respect to time T. Now this area, the reverse area, is approximated as a triangle, approximated as a triangle. Now the charge which is collected in the depletion region must be removed during this reverse recovery time, otherwise your diode will not act as a switch. It causes, or it is a damaging one, so you have to remove the charges formed during this time. So this is reverse recovery time. This is an important one. This is an important one. Now this is approximated to a triangle. You can see triangle, half base into height, half base into height, half base, half. I can see here. See, reverse recovery time is defined like this: IRM into TRR by 2. That is, it is approximated as a triangle, total TRR and IRM, maximum reverse current flowing in the diode. So this total time is 1/4 of IRM. When it reaches, it is called as total recovery time, 1/4 of RS. Now the reverse recovery time TRR is defined as a time or instant between forward diode current becoming 0 and instant of reverse recovery current decaying to 25% of total peak value. You can see here the peak value. You can see the peak value here. Peak value here, and it is reaching 1/4 of this. 1/4 of this. Now this triangle area under this curve is a reverse recovery charge. How? Say product of I into T, Q is equal to I into T. You must know this equation. Charge is given by Q is equal to I into T is charge. Now the area under this curve represents reverse recovery charge. Reverse recovery charge. You can see the equation, half T by 2, it is shown here. This is the equation: IRM maximum value, TRR by 2, half base into height. Now why this is important? Why this reverse recovery time is important for us? Yes, this is used to determine high frequency switching capability. As I told you earlier, it is an important characteristic. One should learn why the reverse recovery time is important. So the data sheets will speak about this reverse recovery time. The switching capability of the diode is decided here, which is an important characteristic. Of course, in our curriculum this is not included, but it is required. Of course, one should know about the forward characteristic, reverse characteristic and this switching characteristics, because most of the power electronics components that are device what you are going to study now, they are all used as switches, very efficient switches. So to know about that, this is an important parameter which determines the switching capability. Yes, signal diode is also a switch you can use, and power diode especially, it is a switch. Apart from that, you have some other areas. The ratio of TB by TA is a softness factor or S factor. During the time TA, the charge is stored in the layer. This is TA. During time TA, the charge is stored in the layer, and TB, the charge is being removed. If S factor is equals 1, it is a soft recovery diode. Soft recovery diode. If S factor is less than 1, it is the snappy recovery diode or fast recovery diode. That means the diode recovers very fast. When we are using this diode as a switch, yes, fast recovery is very much essential. So you keep this S factor less as well as possible. Now coming to the specification of diode, this is important. One should know the specification before you use anything in your circuit. So as an electrical engineer, I should know the specification of a switch, specification of MCB, specification of many more components that I use in my circuit. So also for a power electronics engineer, you should know the device properly. The first one is average forward current. Average forward current, say you are going to connect this diode in forward bias mode, what is the average forward current that it can withstand? This is a parameter which gives suitability to the power circuit, suitability of the device to the power circuit. Reverse blocking voltage, once again, why reverse blocking? Once again, it is a switching characteristic. Reverse blocking, whenever the component is reverse biased. Whenever you increase the source supply in reverse mode, so it goes to destruction. So one should maintain less than this voltage, less than the reverse blocking voltage. So this parameter is also important. And you have remaining parameters as on state voltage, on state voltage to find conduction loss. Once again, loss is prone to occur. Why on state loss is important? So in order to decide the heat sink size, because power diodes, they operate at very high voltage, high current. Once again, the heat sink is obviously required. Once again, next one, the reverse recovery time, you can see the specification given over there. To access high frequency switching capability, you have to decide your device based on this reverse recovery time. Surge current rating, what is meant by surge? To withstand sudden large inrush current. Why inrush current occurs? When you connect a diode across a circuit, you know, when you connect a diode for a simple supply, when you suddenly switch on, when there are no movement of electrons and holes, obviously it is subjected to high inrush current. It should withstand this surge current. Then other specification is I square T rating, short time surge energy withstanding capability, that is required to choose the fuse requirement of the circuit. So these are some specification of the diodes. Then types of power diodes, you can see here, slow diodes having high reverse recovery time of 25 microseconds, suitable for line frequency up to 6 kV and current up to 4500 amperes. You can imagine what is the level of current used in this diode, slow diodes. So it is used in battery charging, electrification, electric traction, electroplating, welding, UPS, etc. Then you have a fast recovery diodes, slow, low reverse recovery time of 5 microseconds. Once again, the switching characteristic is important here, reverse recovery time is important, that characteristic decides about fast recovery diode. So it is used up to 6 kV and 1.1 kiloamperes. You can see the levels of voltage and current. Then this application in SMPS, choppers, combination circuits, induction heating. Schottky diodes, they have low on state voltage drop and the utility of this is around 100 volts, 100 amperes. And this is applicable in high frequency instrumentation and switching power supplies. Silicon carbide diodes, this is not heard of, in fact, you might have not. Silicon carbide diodes, they have ultra low power loss, ultra fast switching behavior, highly reliable, okay, and then is very expensive, in fact. So these are only for listing of power diodes. Of course, the listing of application of power diode is like this. Application of power diode, we can simply write the listing about the application. Next, coming to silicon controlled rectifier, SCR. Now diode is a rectifier. Now it is a silicon controlled rectifier. Now it is a controlled rectifier, and we said diode is a uncontrolled rectifier, wherein there is no control over it. Now, how to control? The SCR circuit symbol is shown over there. It has anode, cathode, and gate. For a particular SCR, 2N368, it is shown here. Of course, the SCR symbol is like this, circuit symbol and terminal identification. Anode and cathode terminal, conventional PN, it is similar to a diode with a gate, addition gate. We call it as a thyristor. So the revolution began from here, SCR or thyristors. Now SCR is a control rectifier, a diode, control diode you can call. Control the conduction under forward bias by applying a current, proper gate current, gate terminal. SCR is unidirectional, it conducts in only one direction, and on the reverse direction it acts as a simple junction diode. That is the SCR. Now you can see few SCRs. So how to identify this SCR? So this is the one. You can see CAG, cathode anode gate. Whenever you take this SCR to conduct an experiment, you should know how to identify the terminals. This is very important. CAG for T1604, it is shown over there. Then what is SCR? It is a four layer PNPN device. You have 4 layers, P forming the anode and N forming the cathode. In between you have another PN layers. The another P layer which is shown in the diagram, you know, so this gate, this acts as a control signal. This gate is a control signal. Now, how to define how the layer structure of SCR? It is a 4 layer device having 3 junctions J1, J2, J3, and it has a gate terminal connected to P. You can see the equivalent circuit of SCR. You can split this PNPN device into a portion like this, PNP and NPN. You can split between these two. And the other diagram which is shown here using NPN and PNP transistor connected back to back like this. In this case, the collector of one PNP connected to base of NPN, collector of NPN connected to the base of PNP. So, this is the equivalent circuit. So, we will be talking about this equivalent circuit sometimes now. So, applying bias, how to bias this? Yes, gate terminal, you have to connect the gate terminal, it is a control signal. Even without control signal, it will work. Let me come to that point now. So, this is a VI characteristic circuit diagram. So, you can try out in your laboratory using TYN616 SCR with components with resistors, and complete experimental setup is shown over there for a 30 volt RPS. This is an experiment, VI characteristic to conduct voltage current characteristic of an SCR. You can try out this in your laboratory definitely, and it works for 30 volts RPS with TYN616, and very easily you can conduct this experiment. Now, this VI characteristic, if you get a question like write the VI characteristic of a diode or explain VI characteristic of a diode, you have to write this diagram or this diagram. So, you are familiar with the laboratory, fine, you are going to conduct the experiment in laboratory, you can write this also, no problem, or this one also, VI characteristic of a diode. Now, VI characteristic of a diode, SCR, the volt ampere characteristic, you can see in the diagram, you know, it conducts in only one first quadrant. There are different modes of operation, forward blocking mode, forward conduction mode, reverse blocking mode. These modes are very important in an SCR. So, when you forward bias your SCR, it is similar to a diode with a gate terminal. So, just like your diode, you know, SCR is forward biased by a positive signal like this, connecting a positive terminal to P, negative terminal to cathode, and a positive gate terminal when you connect, it is said to be in forward bias mode. So, when you increase the voltage, you know, the diode will never, SCR will never conduct, it is in cutoff mode. You have this junction J1, J2, J3, J1 being forward biased, J1, J3 forward biased, J2 is reverse biased here. So, your SCR will not conduct. Now, flipping to this, SCR will not conduct up to the breakover voltage VB0. This is called as a forward breakover voltage. Suddenly after that, the SCR starts conducting and current rises continuously. Then when once SCR starts conducting, you cannot stop conducting of SCR. It continuously conducts. And there are certain other important terms used, latching current and holding current. What is latching current? It is the minimum current required to keep your SCR in conducting mode. The holding current, if you reduce your forward bias current below this value, SCR will turn off, that is all. It is just like you cannot latch without holding. Latching current is always higher than holding current. So, you must hold and latch, you cannot latch and hold. So, this is how you can remember these terms, latching current and holding current. And see, you have the different modes like this. When you increase the gate current, you know, the breakover voltage keeps on reducing as shown over there. The gate current keeps on reducing. You can see the breakover voltage getting reduced as and when you increase the gate current. and the diagram shows for different gate voltages. Now, two transistor analogy of SCR. You can simply explain the two transistor analogy of SCR by this simple circuit. So, in which you have two transistors, PNP and NPN transistors connected back to back. When there is no signal, you know, some small base current is flowing, your Q2 is acting as a amplifier. So, the current increases in Q1. The collector current in Q2 is connected to the base of Q1. Automatically, this Q1 increases its collector current. Now, this collector current IC1 with IB1 combines and increases current in base. Then, because of this, the collector current increases in Q2. This forms a cumulative effect and your SCR goes into conduction mode. So, this you have to explain using two transistor analysis. Using this circuit, you have to explain only this much. See, two transistors, one is PNP, another is NPN, they are connected back to back like this. Because of the base current in Q2, collector current increases. Since the collector current is increasing, the base current of other transistor Q1 is increasing. The cumulative effect of collector current and base current makes this SCR to conduct. Now, this is the two transistor analogy of SCRs. So, this is the total thing that is being covered in this session, in fact, and I am giving you the review questions about this particular topic. Now, review questions, number one is explain the structure of a power diode. You have to write this diagram with N substrate, N minus layer, and then P plus substrate diffused into it. You have to explain the structure of power diode. Draw the wave characteristic of power diode. You show it linear variation in forward bias. It is, you have two forward bias as well as reverse bias characteristic. You show that. Explain the wave characteristic of power diode. Explain means you have to explain how the diode is being forward biased. Whenever it is forward biased, what happens? So, your barrier potential is more in power diode and it conducts at that particular point, that you have to show, and then the variation of this current is mostly linear. Then coming to this SCR, draw the layer diagram of SCR, explain its features. You have to write PNPN device. It is a 4 layer, 3 junction, 3 terminal device, and how we are going to connect anode, cathode and gate, and this with diagram you have to explain. Draw the layer diagram of SCR and explain features. You have to explain the layers about the junctions J1, J2, J3 and its biasing technique, J1, J3 being forward biased, J2 being reverse biased during forward mode, and during reverse mode it reverses. That you have to explain. Then explain two transistor analogy of SCR. Just now I showed you the diagram on the screen. You have to write that particular circuit, or else at least you have to write PNP, NPN transistor bifurcated with base and collector back to back connected, and explain the cumulative effect of these transistors taking your SCR into conduction mode. Then draw the VI characteristic of SCR and label various modes. You have to draw the VI characteristic of SCR, that particular diagram which has been shown, and show it or label it with all modes. Then describe different modes of operation of SCR with the help of VI characteristic. Once again, you have to do that. List the application of power diode and SCR. So, this application. So, these are only the review questions that are important for you. So, before I sign off, you know, so you have to learn about power diode, its importance, its forward bias characteristics, reverse bias characteristics, and then SCR as a control rectifier, and its VI characteristic, its biasing characteristics, its applications, okay, and two transistor analogy of SCR. So, this is an important topic in power electronics. Before you start, before you learn about the next devices, you should know, you should have the knowledge of power electronics, movement of electrons, then molecular theory and layer structure. So, in future, you know, in next sessions, you know, you are going to learn about MOSFETs and BJTs, IGBTs. So, for all these things, This is a basic one. Before you start studying about these devices, layer structures, then semiconductor theory, doping levels, all these things are very, very important for you. So, before, without knowledge of that, if you read, you can't understand anything. That is an important message from my side. So, you should know the molecular theory, then layer theory, so terminologies, and then you have to know about specifications. Then whenever you study about the circuits, so you will be able to appreciate the usage of that particular device and its functioning in that particular circuit. So, thank you.